What's up, guys? Frank here with the man of the hour, Mr. Logan Mader. Last year was a really big year for you. You announced the 25th anniversary of Machine Heads, Burn My Eyes, with the best surprise ever, that you and Chris would be coming back and playing it live. How has the last 9 months treated you?
There was a lot of anticipation and even like a little bit of anxiety leading up, because they made the announcement, I think, in April. Mm-hmm. And then it was like, you know, we did a couple things. We did re-recording Burn My Eyes in the studio, did some rehearsals, a little bit of press and stuff. And then it was like, okay, now wait for 8 months, you know?
Right.
So for me and Chris, especially, there was a lot of like excitement, anticipation, pacing around the house, not eating or shit. We both went through like the same thing. I was in Vegas and he was in Oakland, and we were kind of like going through the same emotional process that was pretty intense and exciting and super emotional, you know, super meaningful. Just, you know, I know, feeling a lot of gratitude for the fact that we get to do this, and that Burn My Eyes even matters now to the point that we can do this.
Does it still feel like reminiscing this far in? Because, I mean, you've been working with them now for 9 months.
And yeah, because like the honeymoon's over now.
Yeah.
It does. Because every night it's the same thing, you know, and it's like, it just keeps coming. And these people keep showing up that are like my age, who love Burn My Eyes and love Machine Head. And then they got their 15-year-old kid with them who's wearing a Machine Head shirt. It wasn't even alive when I was in the band. And he's in a Machine Head too. So you got these multi-generation fans coming out. I call it show cane.
Right. Yeah, I get it. Yeah.
I just learned that word from Jared recently, and it's the best word ever. It sums up the whole thing, like, you know, in a word. A lot of it all comes back, even stuff that I didn't remember until it's like, Chris has a really good memory. He can remember everything, like, and all the details. And I'm like, wow. And he'll bring up things that I hadn't thought about, you know, for 20 years. And I'm like, wow, yeah, that happened. That's awesome. Or we see old pictures and it all comes up, and you hear fans that tell us stories from back when you were in New Jersey this year on the Slayer tour and da da da, and I'm like, oh yeah, and, you know, so it all comes flooding back.
What do you think has been your favorite part of doing these shows so far?
The fact that like I get to relive something that was the apex of my guitar life, you know, that was way in the past, and most people, myself included, could never expect to get to relive that, you know. Mm-hmm. And here I am, you know, 25 years later, and I get to relive it. So that's really kind of surreal and awesome and just like, holy shit, wow. And then when we got to Europe for the first leg of this, it's like, what the fuck? This is like, it's much bigger than what it was when I was in the band. And it was pretty big then too, but it's really developed into this thing that it is. And the way it operates now is on a higher level than it was then. So I was just like, wow. And we have pyro and this full production with two buses and like sick light rig and the whole thing. And
I wonder if what you would tell yourself if, like, you know, somebody came to you then and would be like, well, in 25 years you're gonna get to do this all over again, but it's gonna be very different.
Yeah, I never would have thought that.
Relearning some of this stuff. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you just memorized or you always had it memorized, but was there much of a relearning process for it?
There was, yeah, I had to go back and relearn it. But once I did, it was like, oh yeah, I remember that. And it comes back. There's some distant muscle memory still there.
Looking back so fondly on these songs and relearning them, going through the, like, nitpicking really through every little mm-hmm. thing that happened, do you look back on it and feel that there's anything you'd like to change or wish you could change about it?
Oh man, I mean, any musician would always tell you, like, even a month after their album was released, they probably would have went back and done something a little differently or better. But I mean, yeah, I would have. My perspective on music is a bit different now than it was then. Like, that was my first band. My first time making a record was Burn My Eyes. So, but maybe that's, you know, something that made it special. The fact that it was brand new and, you know, I don't know. But I probably would have done better guitar leads on my guitar solos, at least in my opinion, better than, you know, if I would have to record it now or to write on it now.
Mm-hmm. Do you play the original solos now?
I do. I play them just like they were. Mm-hmm. We stay true to the album. completely in the live performance, with the exception of a couple of little endings, like, you know, live adapted endings of songs and stuff.
And of course, through all of this, you know, you're a really busy man. You got like all the prep work and the touring and everything. Mm-hmm. But this past November, I was fortunate enough to premiere the new Once Human video, Sledgehammer. And it's some of the craziest, heaviest stuff I think you've done so far. We don't really know much about it, though. I know it's supposed to be part of a bigger album coming out sometime soon. I'm not sure, but I wonder if you could tell us anything about it.
Third album for Once Human is in progress right now, and it might come out this year. It kind of all depends on like what the Machine Head Burn My Eyes schedule ends up looking like. It's still being booked, and that's my priority, so I have to be I get to be available for that. And then once I know that, I can plan the rollout for the third album. But it's also still in progress right now, too. And Max and Lauren are at home working on it right now. Finally got to do a couple of live shows together for the first time, and we haven't played for 2 years, because Lauren was really busy doing Camelot, and so we kind of just waited for her to do that. It was really good for her. And then I got the Machine Head stuff happening, so we have this hiatus. But we went and did 70,000 tons of metal cruise recently, so that was a really good kick in the ass to get us in a room together, be a band, do some rehearsals, and then go out and play a couple shows.
I kind of look back at your career, and even with like medication, like everything sounds so different. Like stylistically, they're all very, very different approaches. Even early Once Human stuff to the new song sounds stylistically a little bit different.
Yeah.
Is it fair to say that you like to change it up all the time?
Yeah, I think it's important to apply that mentality in everything that you do in life and in music as well. Otherwise, things get boring and stagnant, I guess. And then Once Human, it's like first record was just me and Lauren, and then Max Karen came in, and he's a huge part of the Once Human sound guitar-wise. He's an amazing writer, and he's so fucking good. It's just like, let him go, and he just keeps, you know, pushing out so much content. My role has been more like producer, mixer, camp counselor, babysitter kind of at this point. But who knows, when I get off this tour, we're gonna grind it out and get it all done. And I may end up actually writing some riffs. I did write some on Evolution, but it was even mostly Max on Evolution as well.
It sounds like you got like a really big mix of ideas and styles in the same band. And do you ever have to like reel it back sometimes? Be like, all right, that's too far.
We do. And I participate in arrangements and this kind of production type of a role. But in reference to like my diversity, I think it has to do with collaboration. Like I think collaboration is really important, and you have the potential to make something much better than what you would just do on your own or what each person would do on their own. So when they get together, it's like, I try to fit in, you know, like with Medication had a thing, and it was writing for Wit, and we had an intention, so I went down that path, and it was totally different than Machine Head or, you know, anything else I've done.
What I love about producers who are also in the band is that you add a pressure to it, you know what I mean? Like, how do you know when an album's done?
I guess they're never done. Well, I mean, you know when it's done. Lauren's really, you know, she writes all her top lines, and she gets involved creatively on the music side as well, and has a lot of opinions. And so when she's happy, I'm happy pretty much, you know. I mean, to some degree.
It's great. Yeah, you need that outside influence to tell you to stop nitpicking sometimes, I guess.
Yeah. And also you need sometimes to push you to, you know, not be lazy or to just, you know, go the extra whatever to get there. When you get with the right people in a recording situation, you know it's a bonding type thing that happens, and inside jokes happen, and you know you're just like on this adventure together. It's almost like touring bonding. You get this bonding thing when you're on this nomadic adventure with this group of people all sharing the same adventure. It's kind of similar when you've got the right chemistry in the studio, even though you're not traveling or going anywhere, but you're on a mission. You're on a mission together.
Right.
Yeah.
Can't wait to hear the new one soon when it's ready. And
yeah, you know, me too.
Yeah. We'll keep you guys posted whenever that happens, and hopefully sooner than later. Till nice. Then, Machine Head, nonstop touring.
Yeah.
And it's going to be a sick show.